Yahshua, Jehovah, and I am inviting you into our home for just a little bit this evening to discuss and learn about the Feast of Dedication, or Hanukkah. We also know it as the Festival of Lights. It is a winter feast, and it happens on the 25th day of the ninth month. Yahovah's month. So therefore, again, calendar is important to find out when the ninth month is. But it starts on the 25th day, and it actually goes for 8 days. Now, something I want you to notice is this word Hanukkah. This is a banner that I made for the Feast of Dedication for our home and our assembly. And you can spell it tons of different ways. Some people spell it with an H, like I did here. And I used to spell Hanukkah this way. Now I reverted, kind of like changed, and I've gone back to spelling it with a CH. So it has more of a Hanukkah. Hanukkah. I have more of a guttural sound. Hanukkah. So, but Hanukkah, the word Hanukkah, if you didn't know, the word Hanukkah actually means, in Hebrew, it means dedication. So we're going to explore this a little bit tonight, and I'll try to move through it pretty quickly because, frankly, it's a tad bit overwhelming because Hanukkah, the Feast of Dedication, is literally so deep and prophetic and profound that there's just so much to talk about with this festival. I absolutely love Hanukkah. I think it is incredibly important for anyone who wants to work for Yeshua and his priesthood, any Melchizedek priest that wants to be working for him needs the process of Hanukkah. And so I'm going to explain that a little bit and unpack that for you. Both Isaac and I think it is so important for you to learn about and then enter into and celebrate. And we're going to tell you why. So as many of you know, Hanukkah is not commanded in the Torah. So you don't see it in Exodus or Leviticus or Numbers or Deuteronomy, but you do see reference to Hanukkah in the sense of dedication in the Torah. You also see Israel familiar with dedication or Hanukkah in the sense of when King Solomon dedicated the temple after he built it. You also see Hezekiah rededicate the temple. You see Daniel prophesy forward about the 2300 days and at the abomination of desolation at the end of that. And that is exactly when Hanukkah was established, at the end of the 2300 days after the Maccabean revolt and when they claimed the temple again. You also see it prophesied in Revelation as the second layer of Hanukkah, where there's going to be another abomination of desolation set up in the third temple. But what is most interesting to me is that Yeshua himself celebrated it. You see in John 10:22, where Yeshua actually went up to the Feast of Dedication, and you see him talk about some beautiful things that we're gonna explore what he talked about during this festival. So you see it mentioned in many places. It's mentioned in the New Testament or in the Brit Hadashah, and you see it in the Old Testament. Where you really see the full story, though, is in the Apocrypha. So the Apocrypha was actually in our canons until I think 1885, somewhere around in there. You can find it in the first and second Maccabees in the Apocrypha. It is considered a historical book, and even though it was once in our canon and considered part of scripture, now it is definitely considered a historical book, and you can find the whole story of Hanukkah in the book of Maccabees. The Feast of Dedication is really all about temple dedication. So Hanukkah is a celebration that remembers the rededication of the temple in 165 BCE. This rededication followed one of the most incredible and greatest military victories of all time. So here's the story of Hanukkah. in a nutshell. There's a lot of history behind it and a lot more that happened after, but in a nutshell, how the Feast of Dedication or Hanukkah was established, we need to know, because the roots of any festival that we celebrate are really important to know so that you know who you're aligning with, what God you're aligning with your celebrations. You want to be celebrating a festival that was rooted in something good, not something wicked and evil. So we're going to discover the roots of Hanukkah by looking at the history of the event that established this festival. So here it is in a nutshell. Antiochus had seized and turned the temple into a stronghold for his gods, for Greek gods, and himself. He put up a statue of himself on the altar. He tore down the original wall and built towers. The altar in the holy place was defiled with pagan pig sacrifices, and we know that that is an abomination according to Yehovah. And so in fulfillment of the 2300-day prophecy of Daniel 8, and against all odds, with the power of Yehovah, a ragtag group of Israelites defeated seasoned Syrian Greco soldiers who were occupying their land and forcing Jews to assimilate into Greek thought. That's called Hellenization. They wanted everybody in the country to assume Greek thought, Greek traditions, Greek education, and Greek culture. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Yeah, I think so. Oh, heavens. But not all Jews surrendered to Hellenization. Well, there was a group of passionate Jewish men, they were actually priests, who fought for religious freedom under a man named Judah Maccabee. And Maccabee actually means hammer. So in Hebrew, the word Maccabee is hammer. They were armed with little more than trumpets and praise, and they freed Jerusalem in exactly 3 years to the day after Antiochus had defiled it. Well, the 10 tribes were already in dispersion. They were already gone. This happened to our brother Judah, and therefore, you know, Judah and Israel, Ephraim, all 12 tribes together are a family. So this happened to family. This is Israel's history. This happened to families. This is our history. So it's really important to understand what this story is all about, right? So you can go ahead and read that story, study into it. There's so much more there. I mean, things like something that I find really interesting is Antiochus had 32 elephants in his army, and each one of those elephants could hold 32 soldiers each. And here, in like 80,000 footmen, and just all these, this huge, vast army coming up against these, you know, this small army over here led by Judah Maccabee. And it is so clear and so obvious that Yehovah gave the victory to Judah and made the enemies reroute. So as we discover the story of Hanukkah, we can see that the roots of it are good. So Judah and all of Israel that was there at the time established this festival. They asked for everyone to keep the days of dedication so that we would remember what Yehovah had done on their behalf back then. I don't think Judah understood or knew the prophetic depth and the implications of the festival that he was establishing, but I have no doubt in my mind that Yehovah, who was with him while he was defeating all these pagan armies, I have no doubt in my mind that Yehovah's Ruach HaKodesh wasn't there with Judah and Israel at the time when they established this Feast of Hanukkah, this Feast of Dedication. So we can see that the roots of Hanukkah are good. They are true. They are something that as Melchizedek priests, we can restore. So just like Judah cleansed the temple, scrubbed it down, and then rededicated it to Yehovah. In fact, Judah chose men who were zealous for Yehovah's law to go in and cleanse the temple and get it ready for dedication again. So as Melchizedek priests, we too can restore. We can look at the roots of Hanukkah and we can say, wow, what an incredible festival. Festival that means something for us today, which we're going to talk about in a second. And we can restore it. We can get rid of all the things that are not true about how it's being celebrated now, and we can restore the true Hanukkah. You can't do this with the other winter feast that's out there called Christmas. It's the roots of that festival are pagan to the core. And the further you go back, the more you know where those roots are, and you know that it is pagan, and you know that it is wicked, and it's straight from the pit of hell. You can't restore that. You can't. There's nothing you can do to wash that clean, because it never came from somewhere clean. But Hanukkah did. And Hanukkah has great implications for us today. So let's go on and continue our journey into learning what Hanukkah is about. Yeah, yeah.
Gonna shine tonight.
Things that I find very interesting about Hanukkah is that from a historical perspective, I did not understand that between the Old Testament and the New Testament, that there was anything being done. When I grew up, obviously I didn't have, like many of you, didn't have the Apocrypha to just read and understand that there was things going on during that time. I was basically taught that Yahweh was silent during those times. So like 400 years worth of silence from Yahweh. Not so, actually. The Apocrypha reveals to us what Yahweh was doing between the Tanakh and the Brit Hadashah. It fills in the gaps. And for me, that was quite wonderful to find out that there was many things going on, that Yahweh was still in the business of preserving his people so that the Messiah could be born. Had the Jews been Hellenized completely, had our brother Judah been assimilated in and lost all identity of who they were and been destroyed, if that had happened, there would have been no Messiah, because it was prophesied that he would come through the line of Judah. But if Judah didn't even know who Judah was, and if Judah was gone, dispersed, if they'd become Greek, there would be no Messiah. Right at the beginning of my teaching on Hanukkah, in case you don't watch any further, I want you to have a takeaway. The whole point of me doing these videos is so that my children someday, their children, and the next generation will remember the ways of Yahweh. And one of the biggest takeaway from Hanukkah is that Hanukkah is all about temple dedication. It is about the God of that temple possessing its house. You see, a temple is a house for a God. And we are temples. And we can house a God of our choice. We've got free will, so we can decide which God is going to inhabit us and possess us. We were made like that. That's how Papa made us. He made us to be living temples. He wanted to live in our hearts. But we have another option. We have the option of allowing the evil one to live in our hearts. So we choose the God of our choice. And during this time of year, during this winter season, you have two choices. You have the choice of Hanukkah or the choice of Christmas. You have the God of Hanukkah that you can invite to live in your temple, or you have the God of Christmas who you can invite to live in your temple. So the biggest takeaway from all of this is that Hanukkah is about rededication of your temple to its original purpose. Its original purpose is to be a house for Yahweh, not a house for Hasatan. You show who owns your house by what celebrations you honor. Abundantly clear who inhabits the houses of those who celebrate Christmas and who inhabits the houses of those that celebrate Hanukkah. The abomination of desolation that Daniel foretold that would happen to the brick and mortar temple, that is prophesied to happen again in the third temple. It is happening right now in the temples of our hearts. Abomination of desolation is going on right now in here. This is why Hanukkah is so incredibly personal. Hanukkah gets really deep and really personal because it actually addresses what is going on in your heart and in my heart. What God have we set up in our hearts, on the altar of our hearts? Is it the God of Christmas? Is it the God of Hanukkah? Is it the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Or is it the God of myself? Or is it the God of another holiday? So you and I are a temple, and our temples need cleansed every year, annually. We need this time. We need this time to remember this whole idea of cleansing and rededication. You have 7 days to cleanse, 1 day to dedicate back to Papa. Yahuwah's Moedim, his appointed days, there are themes, things that he wants to talk about with his people during that time of year. And during Hanukkah, he wants to talk about light, and he wants to talk about dedication, your heart, dedicating your heart back to him, and how to cleanse it, and what it needs cleansed from. And the basic thing is idolatry. Yes, Israel's number one sin has always been and always will be idolatry. Idolatry is none other than worshiping another god besides Yahuwah. We can worship the God of Christmas. We can worship ourselves. We can worship another person. We can worship a thing. We can worship an animal. We can worship a stone image. It doesn't matter. The point is not Yahuwah. And we need to cleanse our heart from all those things that we worship that are not Yahuwah. So we must only serve Yahuwah. Set apart for his temples to do some cleaning, to get cleaned and then rededicated back to his purpose so that the deity can enter his house, so that Yahuwah can then enter his house. But he can't enter our house if our house is full of idolatry, right? Right, if there's a pagan idol on the altar of our hearts, whether that be us or ourselves, or another person, or a thing, like I just said, whatever it be, coffee and donuts, it doesn't matter. If there is something else on that altar besides Yahuwah, we have to cleanse it. We have to get rid of it. We have to burn it. We have to throw it away. And we have to invite Yahuwah back in through his Ruach HaKodesh. He can live in our hearts again, but our hearts have to be clean. You can't have both in your hearts. You're either going to serve one thing or another. Just like Yeshua said, you either serve God or you serve money. You either serve Yahuwah or you serve mammon or whatever. And you can't serve both. You can't do both. Okay, so going a little further here. Let's talk for a second about Christmas and Hanukkah. The idea that Christmas, by celebrating Christmas, you are serving another god. And it's true. The roots of Christmas are evil. They're wicked. They are from another god. Hanukkah, the roots of Hanukkah, are from Yahuwah. You cannot have both of those festivals in the same house. It doesn't work. You can't do both of them. I know some people that try to do both. I don't get it. They don't obviously understand what Hanukkah is about, because Hanukkah is really fully, the whole idea was about cleansing the temple and rededicating it to Yahuwah. And it was freedom from pagan sun god worship. So Antiochus had actually was enforcing pagan sun god worship upon the people. And when Judah came in and got rid of all those idols and cleansed the temple, he was getting rid of pagan sun god worship. That was the goal. That was the idea. So we see here in Hanukkah today, and how Hanukkah gets personal, is that we can't on our hearts have Hanukkah and Christmas. The two are very at odds, because Hanukkah is a celebration from Christmas. Yeah, it's pretty wild. Do you understand that? Hanukkah is a celebration from Christmas. You can't have both. It's like oil and water. If you try to have both, you don't have the real Hanukkah. So this idea of cleansing our hearts and rededicating them back to Yahuwah and His purposes and His ways, and being a temple for Him, a living temple for Him, that is truly the heart of Hanukkah. It is truly the heart of Hanukkah. There's much to be said about light, but if you really want to know what the true Hanukkah is about, that is what it's about. And every year we get a chance to audit our life, look deep into our hearts, and figure out, ask the rock, is there any idolatry in my life, in my heart? Have I set up an idol in Yahuwah's temple? And if I have, help me get rid of it. Because I don't want it. Because I want to serve only Yahuwah. I only want to be a temple for Him. I only want Him to possess this house. No other deity. So that is the heart of Hanukkah. That's the takeaway that I want you to have. If you don't watch any more of this video, please take that much away. Looking forward towards the second layer of the prophetic implications of Hanukkah, not only do we see it prophesied by Daniel that it was going to happen at the end of the 2300 days, but we also see it prophesied in Revelation that it will happen again to the third temple. Yeshua actually references it when he talks to his Talmidim. He says, so when you see standing in the holy place, the rebuilt temple of Yahuwah, the abomination that causes desolation spoken of through the prophet Daniel. So he's referencing Hanukkah, the event that happened there. He's referencing the second layer of Hanukkah that will happen in the future to the third temple. Let the reader understand, and let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. He's actually talking about a future event, like an end of the age sort of thing. All right, and I love this quote by William Denkenbrig. He says, once again, the temple of God will be defiled and polluted by the end time Antichrist, the beast of Revelation, Revelation 13, 2 to 5, 11 and 2, the man of sin or son of perdition, 2 Thessalonians 2, 4 to 10. This beast, like Antiochus, will also trample the holy city of Jerusalem for 42 months, or 1260 days, which is exactly a duplicate. Thus, the tyranny and cruelty of Antiochus Epiphanes was an exact duplicate of the end-time fulfillment to come, even to the exact length of occupation of Jerusalem and the cutting off of the daily sacrifice. So we see this, we see it prophesied that it happened, and it did happen, and it's going to be an exact duplicate in the future. So when you see that happen, Yeshua says, don't stay in town, get out of town, because you don't want to be around when that happens. So we know what to do. In Hanukkah, we see a lot of types, a lot of anti-types, I think. We see a lot of types. And so you see, you know, the abomination of desolation. We see that in the future. We see a type of Messiah in Judah Maccabee in the future. When that final abomination of desolation happens, who is going to be our superhero? It is going to be Yeshua. Of course, he is going to come in and do what Judah Maccabee only dreamed of being able to do. So Judah is, he was only merely human. He couldn't establish peace forever. He couldn't get rid of paganism forever. He couldn't destroy the beast, Antigonus. But Yeshua will be able to do all that. So we see wonderful layers in Hanukkah, the types. My husband has just seen this year in regards to Hanukkah is that the Catholics, I believe, have a day that they call the Feast of Epiphanies. And we all know what Epiphanies means. Epiphanies means God on earth, right? So just a couple days ago, they had a Feast of Epiphanies. And we're curious about that, wondering what that was all about. The idea of a feast to celebrate God on earth. I think the Pope claims that to be God on earth. Antiochus claimed to be God on earth. That's why he named himself Antiochus Epiphanes, because he meant, I am God on earth. That's why you have to obey me, and I'm going to kill you if you don't. But interesting that during this dark time of year, when we start looking at light in regards to Hanukkah, the light of the world came during Hanukkah and was conceived in Miriam's womb. So the Immaculate Conception happened during Hanukkah, during the dark time of the year. So the true God on earth came at the same time as Antiochus was claiming to be God on earth. So anyway, just a little bit of an epiphany there, or a little bit of a revelation that was pretty cool to Isaac this year. Hanukkah is known as the Festival of Lights. Now, there are all kinds of scriptures about light. You have John 12, 35 to 36, when he says, you are going to have the light just a little longer. He's talking about himself. Walk while you have the light before the darkness overtakes you. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they are going. Believe in the light while you have the light, so you may become children of light. 1 Peter 2:9, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, Yah's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of the darkness into this wonderful light. The light of the Melchizedek priesthood is incredible, and I am here to shine some light on the Melchizedek priesthood for your journey. is a huge theme of Hanukkah. Light penetrating our darkness, spiritual darkness. Light is so crucial. If we don't have light, we would die. If we didn't have light to light up the narrow path, we would miss out on the happily ever after. So we need light. It's very crucial. So back in the story of Hanukkah, the temple was dark. And it was dark because the menorah wasn't glowing. With that light from the menorah there in the holy place, the priest had light to be able to see what they were doing, and so they could minister to Yehovah. Well, it's the same thing now. Our bodies are the temple, our hearts are the temple, and if our hearts aren't lit with Yeshua's flame, then we cannot operate as priests. So if we don't have the everlasting flame of Yeshua in us, then we will be unable to do our priestly duties. We need Yeshua's light in us. We need his flame in us to light us up so that we can help other people find the path to the happily ever after. If we don't do that, if we're not lit up by Yeshua, then we ourselves are in darkness, but we are also taking other people into darkness. To have light and to shine it on the path so that other people can get to the happily ever after, that is the point. That is the goal of being a light yourself. Light in the darkness is to help other people see where they're going. Yeah, right. Light in the darkness is to help other people see where they're going. So if you're not shining, then you're not helping anybody see where they're going. If you're putting your light under a table, not putting it on a lampstand like Yeshua told us to do, then you're not being a light, you're not helping anybody get to the happily ever after. A Melchizedek priest will be lit and will be up on a lamppost, shining light so that everybody can see that narrow path. Shadow pictures in it, remember, a lot of types, and one of those shadow pictures is the idea that the everlasting flame that was in the temple that was put out many times, and it's a shadow picture of the better light that will come, that will never go out, which is Yeshua, who did come, and he does not go out. He will never go out. His flame will always burn. Yeshua is the light of the world. He is the only way, and we must be lit by him to become light ourselves. Really cool shadow picture there in the story of Hanukkah, looking towards and forward to the time when Yeshua would come and be the better light to never ever go out, the everlasting flame that would never die. He stands up during the Feast of Dedication and he says, the Festival of Lights, and says, I am the light of the world. So he actually interprets Hanukkah in John. He says it twice during Hanukkah.
The world waits for a miracle. The heart longs
for Yeshua was conceived during the Festival of Lights. The prophetic shadow pictures, the message, that Papa was trying to send by establishing Hanukkah many, many years before, getting Israel to then celebrate this festival of lights, and then giving us the light of the world during the Festival of Lights. I think that the correlation there is amazing. If you doubt that, you can do the biblical math and figure out when Elsheva was pregnant by when Zechariah was in the temple during his services. And then find out when Miriam went to visit her. Yohanan ben Zechariah was born on the high Shabbat of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, so Passover basically, and then Yeshua was born during Sukkot. So you can do the biblical math. Michael Rood's got it all nailed out for you. In fact, Yeshua was conceived during the Festival of Lights, and he was born during Sukkot. He was not born during Christmas. He was born during Sukkot. This whole understanding that Yeshua was conceived during Hanukkah really blows out of the water any argument as to whether Yehovah sanctioned Hanukkah or not, because Yahweh chose the Festival of Lights in which to send his son. Yahweh sanctions Hanukkah because he chooses to send his son, the light of the world, during the Festival of Lights. Year, we have Christmas lights and we have Hanukkah lights, right? We all know that Hasatan is the king of counterfeit. Nothing is his own idea. He always counterfeits Yehovah's. So he has counterfeited Yehovah's light with Christmas lights. So here we have a lot of people saying, it's so wonderful to have Christmas lights in the middle of the dead of winter. No, that is a counterfeit light. It is a false light. The true light is the Hanukkah lights. The true light is the Shamash candle, the one that we need, the everlasting flame of Yeshua. This is a counterfeit light. So don't be ensnared by that. Just know it's very simple. Counterfeit, true. Watching Jim Staley's video on Hanukkah, and he got to the point where he started to talk about his study on fire, and it blew me away. All throughout the scriptures, Yahweh calls himself has something to do with fire. So he's the all-consuming fire, and no one can really stand in that fire and survive. It's kind of like during Pesach when you put the blood on the door and the destroyer came through. That was Yahweh. He comes through and he destroys the firstborn of any home that didn't have the blood on the door. It's the same sort of thing in the sense of, if I don't have what it takes to withstand his fire, when his fire comes through, I will not be able to stand. I will be consumed. So the idea is to become gold, to become a metal, so that silver, gold, so that I can withstand that all-consuming fire and stand during Judgment Day. It was really striking me this year and seeing this Melchizedek connection to Hanukkah and fire, because we see the flaming torch of Genesis 15. Do you remember when Abraham cut the pieces and he walks between them? There's two things that walk between. It's not Abraham. Remember, he puts Abraham into an awake trance kind of thing, and he puts him on the side, and Yeshua goes through on his behalf. There's a flaming torch and a smoking furnace. The smoking furnace is Yahweh. The flaming torch is Yeshua. So they go together through those pieces. They're making the covenant basically between Elohim and Abraham, but Yeshua is standing in for Abraham on his behalf and his descendants' behalf. The flaming torch, it was Yeshua. And we see that fire show up again when the light of the world comes during Hanukkah and is conceived in Mary. He is the light of the world. So he is the flame. He is the everlasting flame. He's He is the pillar of cloud, basically. And remember when the Ruach was given at Shavuot, all the people were there waiting for the gift of Yeshua. He had to leave so they could send the Ruach HaKodesh. And how does he give the Ruach HaKodesh? He gives the Ruach HaKodesh, we see wind, and we see almost like the pillar of cloud break apart, like this everlasting flame of Yeshua just bust apart, and it lands on top of every single one of the people's heads that were like a flame on top of their head. It's like lighting them up. They're wicks. We are wicks, and he is the flame. He is the light. It's like this flaming torch in Genesis 15 that walked through the pieces who could withstand Yehovah's all-consuming fire, now is busted apart and lives in us and actually allows us to stand and withstand that all-consuming fire. So the goal is to be able to withstand Judgment Day. And if we have Yahuwah's fire in us through the work of Yeshua and the Ruach HaKodesh, if that same fire is living in us, then we can stand that day. And also, if you look at the idea of fire refining something, burning out all the chaff and cleansing something and bringing about gold, gold can withstand the fire. So if you're perfected, if you're purified, if you're silver, gold, then you yourself will be able to stand Judgment Day and stand it when the all-consuming fire comes through. I think that is an incredible Melchizedek connection to Hanukkah. Okay, so just real quickly, we're going to look at the fact that Yeshua celebrated Hanukkah. We see that at peril to his own life, he shows up to Hanukkah. Now, just a few months before, during Sukkot, Yeshua went up to Sukkot, but he went incognito. He went kind of secretly because it is a commanded festival you have to show up in Jerusalem for. So he did go, but they were wanting to kill him then. So that death threat still was hanging over his head, but he felt Hanukkah was so important that he went up to the festival, to the Feast of Dedication, to interpret it for us. If you read the chronological Gospels, we will discover what happened during Hanukkah. On the first day of Hanukkah, they tried to stone him, but he hid himself, and then he escaped out through the midst of them. On the second day of Hanukkah, they were going to stone him again for claiming to be Elohim, and he escaped out of their hand again. So Hanukkah was definitely a time that he felt was really important to go up to. He risked his life to go there and to interpret it for us. So I think we should pay attention to it since he did that and risked his life to do it.
The air is cold tonight. There's gunpowder in my eyes. This is the eve of battle.
So we see that all the things that Yeshua chose to speak about during the Feast of Dedication really support the roots of Hanukkah. So one of the things that's really important to do is as you try to figure out what Yeshua was doing during Hanukkah and what he spoke about during Hanukkah is to look at his life chronologically and figure out where he was during what feasts and what he was speaking on during the feast, because he interprets most of all of Papa's festivals. The chronological Gospels helps us know where he was during Hanukkah. We see that in John 10:22 that it tells us all these things that have happened. It tells us where he was and what was going on. So in John 10:22, it says it was winter, and it says that all these things took place at the Feast of Dedication. So here you have several chapters that have gone on. You don't quite know where he is, and then you find out, oh, he's been right here. So that's very helpful. So let's look now at what Yeshua was speaking about during Hanukkah, because I think as a follower of Rabbi Yeshua, I want to know what my rabbi was talking about during Hanukkah. I think that he interprets Hanukkah in incredible ways. The layers and the depths that he brings to it shines a lot of light on why this feast was so important to him to come up and interpret for us. Okay, to start off with, Yeshua calls himself the light of the world twice during Hanukkah. You see it in John 8:12, where he says, Yeshua spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He that follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. John 9:5 says, as long as I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. So this is during Hanukkah that he's talking about himself being light. So literally, Yeshua is the fulfillment of Hanukkah in that he is the everlasting flame. He is the light of the world. He is the better light that will never go out. And he is the fire that will that he can put in us to save us from the all-consuming fire that will cleanse the earth one day of all sin. He talks about the job of a Melchizedek priest in that he talks about Yahweh being his father and that he was about his father's business. So therefore, as followers of Yeshua, we should be about what he was about. He talked about doing the works of Abraham. So the works of Abraham being pre-covenant would be Melchizedek in nature, so we should be doing the works of Abraham. So Yeshua talked about bondage and freedom. You know, the Pharisees that came to him during that time said that they were not slaves, and Yeshua was saying they were slaves to sin. And if you look at what kind of happens around us right now, you look at people that celebrate Christmas, and they are slave to that holiday. There is, you just can't get rid of it. It's like a pitch. It gets on you and you can't get rid of it. Or like a bad headache. It's like a bad nightmare. It won't go away. So you are a slave to that holiday and the God of that holiday. And he was calling the Pharisees back then slaves to sin. Idolatry is a sin, so therefore the same thing's going on right now. But he also said in the same breath that the truth will set you free. So if we know the truth about Christmas, and we want eyes to see and ears to hear, and we ask for the Ruach HaKodesh to give us eyes to see and ears to hear, and we see the truth about it, then we will turn and we will be set free through the Feast of Dedication, through the Festival of Lights, this beautiful festival of Hanukkah. We will be set free from pagan sun god worship. During this time of year, that's a good thing to be set free from. It is so in our face. It's everywhere. This isn't something just spiritualized. This isn't, we're not just talking metaphorical. We're talking a real, live, tangible thing that's going on. We need set free from. We need set free from Christmas. And we're going to be set free from Christmas by understanding the truth about it and turning and repenting and teshuving and saying, Papa, I want to celebrate your ways. Teach me. One who worships idols is not free. You're only free if you're worshiping Yahuwah and doing things His way. That is true freedom, because He is the author of freedom. Hasatan is the author of bondage and slavery and death. The truth will set you free. Not just metaphorically, not just in your mind, but truly real. I mean, how many people do you see are slaves to this? Just imagine trying to get rid of Christmas in your life if you haven't already. If you have, you know what kind of price you've paid. It's a high cost for following Yahuwah and obeying and getting rid of idolatry in your life. When everyone around you, your family, friends, everyone else is doing it, you might get away with not doing it for a year or two, but try pushing that longer and everybody is going to be going, why aren't you showing up to our Christmas dinner, our Christmas tradition? And when you choose to leave and not celebrate with them, the cost is pretty high. You're going to lose a lot, but you're going to gain truth. At all costs, gain truth. Okay, so then another thing that Yeshua talked about during Hanukkah was blindness. Having eyes to see and ears to hear. So Yeshua heals this man born blind. And I absolutely love this story if you continue reading it, because what happens is, you know, Hanukkah is all about the heart. So this is during the Festival of Lights. This is during Hanukkah. And it's all about the condition of the heart, right? And so he heals this man born blind and sends him to the synagogue to do whatever he needs to do there. The guys of the synagogue, the Pharisees, the religious leaders, basically are like, who did this to you? And why did they do it on a Shabbat? And so they basically, over the course of interviewing his parents and all this other stuff, they kick him out of the synagogue. So that basically means you lose. He lost a lot by having to leave the synagogue and being kicked out. You know, your community, family, all this stuff. So place, position, he lost a lot. And what does Yeshua do? Yeshua goes out after him and he finds him. And I just think this, that whole action of him moving towards that man and finding him and saying, you know, I'm so sorry that they did this. Do you want to know who healed you? And that whole scene is beautiful because Yeshua is taking care of that man's heart during Hanukkah. And then Yeshua, you know, as I said before, he talked about the sheep and the sheepfold, that that his sheep would hear his voice. He speaks this during Hanukkah. So during the abomination of desolation that happens every single year at this time of year during the winter when you have the festival of Christmas, sheep are going to hear the call of one or the other. Sheep are going to hear the call of the God behind each one of those. And so I'm going to suggest that his sheep hear his voice when he calls them to celebrate Hanukkah. If you hear his voice about Hanukkah and you follow him into celebrating this feast, you are part of his sheepfold. You are his sheep. If you choose to celebrate Christmas and you don't hear his voice, you're not his sheep. Or if you choose to boycott Hanukkah and you don't hear him calling you into this festival, I'd like to suggest that he is saying that his sheep are going to hear him call to them during the Festival of Lights, during the Feast of Dedication. Because this festival, this feast, is so important about cleansing your heart from idolatry and rededicating it back to its original purpose. He's going to need sheep who are willing to do that. And if you don't, you're not actually of his fold. If you are disgusted with idolatry and the pagan ways, you're one of those that hear his voice. You're one of those that he is calling. You're part of his sheepfold. If you're enamored with the pagan ways and you don't care and you think it's great and it doesn't bother you or affect you, then you're not hearing his voice. Therefore, you're not part of his sheepfold. I'd like to suggest that that is what he's saying. A couple other things that he talks about during Hanukkah, he talks about life, about having life abundantly. He talks about the better way that, you know, Miriam chose versus Martha. He was actually at their home during the last part of Hanukkah. And so he talks about the better choice that Miriam was making, that she was getting lit from his flame. She was a wick getting lit from his flame. While Martha was just busy and just so busy she didn't have time for Yeshua. He said that the father of the religious leaders was Hasatan and that there was no truth in them. And they were full of lies. Isn't this very true today? We look at the religious leaders today and all of them, almost all of them who are in charge of a church somewhere are pushing Christmas. They're pushing a pagan holiday on the people. They are teaching the people to celebrate pagan days, idolatry, and they're full of lies. Their father is Hasatan. Same, it hasn't changed. What was at the time of Yeshua still happens today. So he's talking about the religious leaders feeding his sheep lies. Lies about false gods, false religions, false holidays. Why Hanukkah is 8 days. There is a reason, and a lot of scholars say, well, it was established because Israel hadn't been able to celebrate Sukkot for so long, so many years, and Sukkot was the last feast, so that was on their minds and their hearts, and they wanted to enter Sukkot again. And granted, there are some references to the Feast of Tabernacles in there, you can see that, but Isaac and I feel, as we've studied Hanukkah, that it was set up for 8 days more out of the idea that they were following Torah protocol when it came to how to dedicate, rededicate an altar to Yehovah. So we think that is more like the reason it probably was it for 8 days. We also see the importance of 8 days in regards to where the temple is now, because 8 days is time. You have time. The pagan holidays, there's no time, right? Christmas is one day. You basically are in this frenzy to get to that one day. So in the book, The Feast of the Lord by Howard and Rosenthal, they say in the scriptures, an 8-day period was always the pattern of dedication. That is, the object to be dedicated was set aside or sanctified for 7 days, And then on the eighth day, it was holy, set apart, made kodesh to the Lord, to Yahuwah. So we can see that according to the Torah, it takes 8 days to dedicate a new altar to Yahuwah. And in Hanukkah, we see the same pattern of an 8-day cleansing and rededication process. So after the Maccabean revolt in 165 BCE, Judah set aside 8 days for the festival as a remembrance of the 8 days that it took to cleanse and rededicate the new altar after the abomination that was committed by the Greeks. So we can see many Torah commands and situations for supporting this idea of an 8-day dedication. Just look with me. We see that the priests would sit in the doorway to the tent of meeting for 7 days. On the 8th day, they would enter into their priestly ministry. They would enter into the tent of meeting and start their ministry to Yahuwah. So it's kind of like their ordination. Interesting that before they sat in the door of tent of meeting in the doorway, and they watched him do his ministry to Yahuwah, they watched him do that. And then they sat in the doorway to the tent of meeting for 7 days. And then we see them enter into ministry on the 8th day. And you see the first things that they do is to do exactly what Moses did just 7 or 8 days before. So it's very prophetic in its implications, because as Melchizedek priests who want to work for Yeshua and in his kingdom and for his priesthood, we look at what Yeshua did. He's our rabbi, our high priest and king. He's the one that we look at to see what does it look like to be operating as a priest, to do ministry to Yahuwah. What does that look like? So we look and see what Yeshua did, and we watch what he did, and then we sit in the doorway basically for 7 days during Hanukkah, and on the 8th day, we then enter into ministry to Yahuwah. And what is the first thing we do? We do exactly what Yeshua did. We mimic Yeshua. He is our example for what we need to do. We do exactly what he did. So this is incredibly profound and important for people who are entering the Melchizedek priesthood. There's a process. There's actually a two-step process to becoming ordained, if you want to say, into priesthood. We see it in the Torah protocol, and we see it reflected in the story of Hanukkah. You want to work for Yahuwah, you want to do ministry for Yahuwah, there's a two-step process. Actually, if you want to think about it, there's a four-step process. You watch what Yeshua did, you study what he did, cleanse yourself from all idolatry, and then you rededicate your temple back to Yahuwah to be about your original purpose, and then you mimic what Yeshua did. You do exactly what he did. That is the process of priest ordination back then and today. As Melchizedek priests, we need Hanukkah. We need the process of Hanukkah in order to be effective for Yahuwah, in order to work for Yahuwah, and to work in Yeshua's royal priesthood. We need this festival to walk through the cleansing and the rededication, flanked by looking at his example and then doing exactly what Yeshua did. Okay, so going on into seeing what other situations we see in the Torah in regards to an 8-day dedication process, this Hanukkah process of cleansing and rededicating, we see that in order to be cleansed from all kinds of different impurities, it took an 8 day. It was completed on the 8th day. We see that in Leviticus. We also see the firstborn of livestock that was dedicated to Yahuwah on the 8th day. And then we see that all sons were dedicated to Yahuwah and circumcised on their 8th day of life. Yeshua's parents followed this Torah protocol. He was born on the first high day of Sukkot, and on the last high day of Sukkot, which was Shemini Atzeret, a high Shabbat, he was circumcised on that day. We also see that the original altar in the temple was sanctified for 7 days, and then on the 8th day, it was holy. It was deemed holy on the 8th day. King Hezekiah cleansed the temple and rededicated to Yahuwah after 8 days. We also see that during the dedication of Solomon's temple, we see a celebration for 7 days, and then a special assembly on the 8th day. In the Brit Hadashah, we see what the temple is. It's defined in there for us as to where the temple is now, because the temple is not in a brick and mortar place anymore. It actually resides here in our living temples. So 1 Corinthians 6:19 says, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Ruach HaKodesh who is in you? You are not your own." So we see here that your body is a temple. Therefore, you must be careful what you do with your body, what you put in your body, what you eat, what you drink, what you choose to do with your body. It must be in line with Yahuwah because your body is a temple for Him. We also see that our hearts are the temple. So our bodies house our hearts. Very cool, huh? So don't you know that you yourselves are Yah's temple? So you yourselves is at your truest core is your heart. You yourself, your truest self is your heart. So your body and your heart are temples, are a temple to Yahuwah. But one thing that struck me this year, and I didn't realize it, I don't know why I didn't see this before, but we are also collectively Yahuwah's temple. In fact, there are more times that it's talked about us being collective temple than individual temples. So of course, if the individual temple isn't cleaned of idolatry and dedicated back to Yahuwah, then of course the collective isn't going to work either. So we've got to get the individual temples cleaned up. But we also have to consider the collective temple and cleaning the collective temple. So interesting. He says, Yeshua Messiah himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together is growing into a holy temple in Yahuwah, in whom you also are being built together into a dwelling of Elohim in the Ruach HaKodesh. So if you notice, he's talking about the collective, as in 2 Corinthians 6:14 to 16, "For we are the temple of the living Elohim," we being collective. Just as Yahuwah said, "I will dwell in them and walk among them." So together we make up his temple. Don't you know that you yourselves are Yah's temple? Like we talked about before, but the verse goes on. And it says that the Ruach HaKodesh dwells in our midst. If anyone destroys Yahuwah's temple, Yahuwah will destroy that person, for Yahuwah's temple is sacred, and together you are the temple. It actually says that right in there. So together we are the temple. What does Yahuwah want us to do with this temple? So he says very clearly all throughout scripture, purge your temple of all idolatry. I mean, Israel's number one sin has always been idolatry, and it will always be idolatry. So we are always trying to cleanse ourselves from idolatry, whether that be worshiping ourselves or whether that be worshiping another god or whatever. As if it's not worshiping Yahuwah, it is idolatry. So Yahuwah wants us to purge our hearts, purge our bodies, purge our collective temple from all idolatry. So it says in Joshua 24:14, "Now therefore fear Yahuwah and serve him in sincerity and truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve Yahuwah." In Psalms 51:10 it says, "Create in me a clean heart, O Yahuwah, and renew a steadfast spirit in me." In Ezekiel 36:25 it says, "I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all of your idols." So we need to be cleansed from all of our idols. That's how we take care of the temple. So looking at cleansing our own bodies and our own hearts is one thing, but looking at cleansing a collective group of our assemblies and stuff, that's another one that we need to deal with. Basically, you look at your assembly and see if there's idolatry going on in there. And if there is, then with love and kindness, we go and we try to purge that idolatry out of our assemblies and out of our collective Israel. So definitely something to practice and use a lot of love with doing. Yeshua said that that his priests will be known by their love. And if you don't have any love, then you're a clanging cymbal. So make sure, and when you begin the process of looking at your collective temple, like it's said we're supposed to do, do it with love. Do it with love. Because as you judge, so therefore with what measure you shall also be judged. So love, absolutely. Just don't forget. You see a process of Hanukkah It's a cleanse and rededicate. We're cleansing temples, rededicating temples. Rededicating our bodies, our hearts, and our collective temple back to the original purpose, back to Yahuwah. Thus is the beauty and the climax of Hanukkah. Where the temple is now, it's in a living temple. So therefore, this living temple gets to choose. I get to choose which God I want to live in my temple. A brick and mortar temple doesn't get to choose. It's just made and dedicated. It's non-living. But this living temple gets to choose. This is a beauty of free will. So there is not one other festival of Yahuwah's that deals directly with idolatry. Idolatry is Israel's number one sin. It always has been, and it still is. So to have a festival established for Israel to consider idolatry, to think about it, to do an audit of their life, it's very needed. And every year, you need to set apart this time to just look at your life, and look at your heart, look at your temples, and consider what Yahuwah wants to talk to us and to you about during this season. He wants to talk about idolatry that you may still have in your heart. He wants to talk about cleansing it. Let's get rid of it and then rededicating it back to him so he can live there through the Ruach HaKodesh and ignite your wick with Yeshua's flame so that you can be light. That's the whole point. This is the climax of Hanukkah. Beautiful. So as I was studying about Hanukkah again this year, I ran into a peer-reviewed article written in 1910 from a guy named Montgomery. And he was looking at dedication in the Old Testament, trying to find a link between the Feast of Dedication that Yeshua attended and how Israel was familiar with dedication in the Tanakh or in the Old Testament. So his study was very interesting. And what one of the things that he said that I really took to heart and kind of blew me away was his quote. I'll quote him here. He says, "We might expect," he's talking about dedication. He's talking about dedication of the temple. So when King Solomon is standing there inviting Yahuwah to come and live in the temple, this is what he's talking about. "We might expect it to be the dramatic reproduction of the original act whereby the deity took possession of its house." So King Solomon built a house for Yahuwah and he invites the deity to come live in his house. So a temple. A temple is a house. It's a house for a god. We are temples. We are a house for a god. We were created that way. But we are living temples, so we get to choose which deity we want to inhabit our temples. That is a lot of freedom. It blows me away that we get so much freedom to choose which god we want to inhabit our temple. The deity, whatever deity it is that you want, will enter your temple, and that deity will own your temple. That's how it works. So worship is, according to John Eldridge, I love how he says this, worship is what you give your heart over to in trade for life. So worship is not an hour-long praise service at church on the weekend. Worship is what you give your heart over to in trade for life. So I personally am giving my heart over to Yahuwah in trade for life. So really consider what you're giving your heart over to, and really reconsider the definition of worship, because you can have all kinds of great, wonderful song services that say worship service, but that's not true worship. That's praise, that's wonderful. Singing to Papa is wonderful, but only if your life is aligned with him and during the week you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. So if you come only on the weekend and sing songs to him for an hour and you think you've worshiped him, no, worship is walking it out. Worship is walking out your obedience to him. So idolatry would be saying, I'm God, I can decide for myself what I am supposed to be doing with my life, and therefore you put yourself up on a pedestal as Antiochus Epiphanes did and said, I know what's right and wrong. I know what I need to be doing with my life, and I don't need to, I can ignore Yahweh. So that is idolatry. You're worshiping yourself. But during this dark season, during the darkest time of the year, we have two festivals to celebrate. One is pagan and one is from Yahweh. And we're going to give our hearts over to the worship of one of those, because we're giving our heart over to this celebration in trade for life. You just look at the roots of Christmas, okay? Just for a second, we'll look at the roots of Christmas. You can go study about the roots of Christmas, but basically, here's the roots of it are, there's this big potbelly god. He gets all fiery red, and the worshipers would give something very precious to them. So idolatry, the demands of idolatry is that you give your very prized possession to it. And this is what makes desolate, because when you give your very most prized possession to this this god other than Yahweh, it's going to make desolate. It's going to destroy what it is that you're giving it. When you give yourself to Yahweh, you're not destroyed. You get more life. But when you give yourself to Hasatan and his ways, you're destroyed. He's a thief. He steals, kills, and destroys. So he's going to steal from you, rob from you. So here's this pot-bellied god, made hot and red from a fire, and the ancient people would take their most precious gift, which was their babies, and they would put it on the fire, and they would offer this in trade for life. What they were hoping for was good weather, good crops for the next year. So they're trading this prized possession for life in the future. But look at what we do now. So you have Santa, who sits on this throne. He's big pot-bellied, he's just red and everything. We give our screaming kids to this guy who's probably a drunk off the street. We give our screaming kids to this guy in trade for life, because he says, what do you want? What do you wish for? So it's a big wish fest. So you're sitting on his lap, and the kids or the parents or whatever are helping the kid tell Santa what it is they want. It's basically life. They're asking for life. It's the same thing. It's the same festival. It's just wrapped in a different package. So it will make desolate. So basically, the kid will ask for whatever, and more than likely, that kid will not get what it is asking for. But by celebrating Yahweh's ways, it's true, and it's not going to make your heart desolate. It's not going to make the temple desolate. So as we just talked about, idolatry demands that you give it your most prized possessions. You give it your heart. Or you give it your children. When I celebrated Christmas, I was giving my children to that holiday. And I have repented. And every year during this dark season, I actually feel the rock moving on me. And I just am overwhelmed with the sins of my youth. And I am repentant once again. Just unbelievable grief comes over me as I remember the sins of my youth and remember that I once taught my daughters and those around me to celebrate pagan ways and a holiday that is based in pure evil, in human sacrifice, and in ways that are not Yahweh's ways. And I was trying to make it what I wanted it to be. And I'm just moved to tears every year to say I'm sorry again, and I want to walk with you, Papa. I don't live there. I'm done grieving over that for sure, but the Ruach moves on me every year just a little bit, and I realize again that and I once was doing that. I was celebrating pagan ways and pagan holidays, and now I will spend the rest of my life celebrating Yahweh's things, teaching Yahweh's ways, and teaching my children his ways and not the pagan ways. So 2 Corinthians 6:14-18 says, do not be bound together with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness and lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? Or what harmony has Yeshua with Baal? Or what has a believer in common with an unbeliever? Or what agreement has the temple of Yahweh with idols? For we are the temple of the living Elohim. Just as Yahweh said, I will dwell in them and walk among them, and I will be their Elohim, and they will be my people. Therefore, come out of the midst of them and be separate. Be holy, be kadosh, be set apart. Says Yahweh, and do not touch what is unclean, and I will welcome you. Do not touch what is unclean. Idolatry is unclean. Christmas is unclean. Don't touch it. If you want to be a temple for Yahuwah, don't touch it. If you're still touching it, go look at it, discover it, pray for eyes to see and ears to hear, but don't touch it. It is unclean, and He cannot accept you if you're touching that unclean thing. If you look at Christmas and when it was actually illegal in the United States, so the Puritans coming over knew that Christmas was an evil holiday, and they didn't want any part of it. They were running from all that stuff, and they didn't want it over here, and it actually became legalized in the late 1800s. So up until then, you would be thrown in jail for celebrating Christmas. It has nothing to do with Yahuwah, so, and nothing to do with His ways. Even the early settlers knew that. That kind of blows my mind that we have forgotten only 150 years ago, if and less, that that it was illegal here in this country to celebrate Christmas. Normal, rational people tend to look and go insane during this time of year. It's like the God truly possesses them. Their ability to rationalize is completely gone. You can't talk to them. It's like they have blinders on. They can't see anything. They have given themselves over to that God, and that's all they see is December 24th. They have to have all the presents that they need under the tree. They have to have the tree up and the lights up, and they have to have decorations up, and everything has to be done by that day, and they can't see straight until they get there. What's the point of that day? It is the birthday of every pagan god on the planet and every sun god, and has nothing to do with Yeshua. Normal, well-adjusted people seem to go somewhat psychotic during this time of year, and their sanity basically takes a holiday. They literally become possessed. The deity is possessing their house and forcing them into doing what the deity wants them to do. They're slaves. Just as an example of this frenzy I'm talking about, we have a friend who's a mortgage lender, and he was doing probably a refi or something for a family who had to have certain presents for their kids or whatnot for Christmas, and they were refiing their house, and the frenzy was so owning them that my friend had to chase them down in the stores to get their signatures on the contract so that my friend could get them the money that they needed to buy what they needed so they could put it under the tree for the holiday. Talk about creepy. Talk about insanity. That's insane. That is completely insane to go to all that trouble to refi your house so you can afford presents on Christmas. That really shows the bondage of that person to that holiday. But you see how it owns people. But Hanukkah is actually a celebration from freedom from that possession. We see Hanukkah as a freedom from that possession. Do you see how it's provision? If you don't see it, you're blinder than a bat. I pray that you have eyes to see and ears to hear, my friend. So we get to keep our sanity during the same time of year as everyone else seems to be going a little loco. Yahweh wants us to live. He wants us to have life abundantly. And idolatry will eventually lead to death because it goes against our original design. Our original design is to be living temples of Yahweh. But when you put desolation in there, and when you put other gods in there, it's going to destroy Yahweh's creation. So Yahweh gives us a command, and He says, do not have any other gods in my face, right? He says, Deuteronomy 5, 6 to 8, He says, I am Yahweh your Elohim who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods in my face. You shall not make for yourself an idol in any form of heaven above, on earth below, and worship it, basically. Then He says, when you enter the land which Yahweh your Elohim gives you, you shall not learn to imitate the detestable things of those nations. So here we have the same situation. We have, as an Israelite, we have the practice of the nation around me. I can't practice their ways, and I can't worship Yahweh in their way. Watch this. In Deuteronomy 12, 30 to 31, He says, be careful not to be ensnared by inquiring about their gods, saying, how do these nations serve their gods? We will do the same. You must not worship Yahuwah your Elohim in their way, because in worshiping their gods, they do all kinds of detestable things that Yahuwah hates. They even burn their sons and daughters in the fire as sacrifices to their gods. So we can see very clearly that Yahuwah says, don't learn the ways of the nations around you, and then practice their ways and say you're doing it to me. That's what we've done with Christmas, is it not? Learn this pagan feast, Saturnalia, and all the horrible things that it is about. And we say, oh, no, we're going to make it about Jesus, about his birth. No. It doesn't work that way. Yahweh says, don't do that. We were learning the ways of the nations, and we're trying to worship Jesus in this festival. It has nothing to do with him. In fact, it's everything anti him, because it's anti-life, because it's worshiping another god. And we want him to be pleased with that. Well, the question is not what does it mean to me, but what does it mean to Yahuwah? So we see that by following in the traditions of the nations around us and trying to worship him in their way, he hates that. He's displeased with that. He doesn't want us to do that because it reminds him of the ways that they were celebrating by destroying his creation, by burning up living people. That's murder. He's not. No. Just say no. In 1 Corinthians 10:21, it says, you cannot drink the cup of Yahuwah and the cup of devils. You cannot be partakers of Yahuwah's table and the table of devils. So therefore we see that Hanukkah and Christmas can't exist together in the same room, because one is Yahuwah's table and one is the devil's table. You can't have both. You cannot partake of the devil's table and expect to just throw a little Jesus in there and expect Yahuwah to accept it, because he's saying clearly there's a division between the ungodly and the godly, between the unholy and the holy, and we are supposed to teach our children the difference between the unholy and the holy. And during this time of year, when you have the unholy holiday of Christmas and you have the holy holiday of Hanukkah, that choice is ever before us. We have a decision to make during this time of year. Will we be for Yahuwah, or will we be for Hasatan? Very briefly, I want to address the 7 objections to celebrating Hanukkah. And I'm going to do it really briefly, okay? So just bear with me, because there are some people who are not sold on the idea that Hanukkah is from Yahuwah. Number 1 objection that we hear is that Yeshua did not participate in Hanukkah, but protested Hanukkah instead. Can you imagine Yeshua standing outside the temple with a protest sign, do not celebrate Hanukkah? First of all, it wasn't Yeshua's habit to go up to a pagan celebration and protest it. You don't see that anywhere in the scriptures. So if Hanukkah was pagan and he was up there to protest it, that is a one-time thing. We don't have any other witness to him ever doing that. He wasn't protesting it. He was participating in it. He was actually in the temple during Hanukkah. Some people say, well, he was actually outside the temple with a picket sign. No, he wasn't. He actually went into the temple, in the treasury in the temple. In John 8, you'll see where he was during the first part of Hanukkah. He was in the temple teaching during Hanukkah. Topics that he taught about, they all match the themes of Hanukkah. We also see that Yeshua actually mentions the abomination of desolation, which is tied intrinsically to Hanukkah. We see him talk about the future second layer of Hanukkah that's spoken of in Revelation. Finally, Yeshua actually risked his life to go up to Hanukkah. Yeshua did participate in Hanukkah. He was not protesting Hanukkah. Thank you. it's not in the Bible. So it's not commanded in the Bible, so therefore I don't have to celebrate it. Hanukkah is actually mentioned in the Gospel of John, as we've already talked about. Hanukkah is prophesied in Daniel, which we've already talked about. It is a future fulfillment in Revelation, which we've already talked about. We've already talked about the fact that it is in the Apocrypha. The historical event is found in the Apocrypha, which was actually part of our canon of scriptures up until 1885, I believe. And then we also see Purim as precedence. So in the Book of Esther, we see the establishment of Purim. And Purim was a celebration of the victory of Israel over their enemies again. It was a celebration to remember what Yahweh had done for Israel back then. It was Queen Esther and Mordecai that commanded Israel to celebrate Purim. We see that there is a precedent set with Purim. So Purim is actually in our scriptures as it stands today. And it is commanded for us to keep. Thus, it is precedence for Hanukkah. Number three, people say, well, it wasn't sanctioned by Yahweh because it wasn't given in the Torah commands when all his modim were given, commanded back there. But in actuality, we see that Yahweh chooses the Festival of Lights in which to send his son to be conceived in Miriam. So he sanctions it by sending his son to be conceived in Miriam during this time. By the way, the miracle that did happen there, of course, was not the oil that lasted for 8 days, but the miracle that did happen there was that the Immaculate Conception happened, that Yeshua was planted in the womb of Miriam during the Feast of Hanukkah. That was the true miracle that happened there. And objection number four is Hanukkah is a Jewish version of Christmas. Well, of course it's going to be if you're just not looking for the true Hanukkah, and then Christmas is going to infiltrate Hanukkah because that's what Hasatan does. But the call on a Melchizedek priest is to restore. So cleanse and rededicate. So the job of a Melchizedek priest is to look at Hanukkah and find the true Hanukkah and give it back to the people. The modern celebration of Hanukkah has very little to do with the original Hanukkah. So left on its own to be infiltrated by Christmas, yes, it's going to look like Christmas, but it doesn't have to. Melchizedek priest can clean it and take away the things that are not good and restore it and give it back to the people so that they can have this beautiful festival during this time of year to consider their heart. The fifth objection is that it is a national Jewish holiday and I'm not Jewish. If you realize that you are part of Israel, then you have a family, and part of that family is Judah, right? You're Ephraim, they're Judah, one family. It happened to family. It's a national holiday for all of Israel. So there are some people that actually are saying that it's pagan and its roots are in the celebration of Saturnalia, that the candles here, the nine candles, actually represent the solar system, different things like this, but that's crazy making, because you have to look back at the roots of it, and the roots of it are good. The solar system is actually got more than nine, some dwarf planets in there and whatnot. So the menorah is to count the days of Hanukkah. It has nothing more. There's no other meaning in this Hanukkah here except just to help us count the days of Hanukkah, and the shamash candle being representative of Yeshua. People say that because Hanukkah falls during this time of year, that it's by association it's bad. But by association, it's not bad. We're associated with pagans all the time, but I'm not pagan. So, number seven, people say, well, the Maccabees usurped the Zakodiate line. Zadokite line, the priestly line, and instituted their own priestly line. Therefore, Yeshua wasn't celebrating it. But you know what? Yahweh creates Adam and Hava. They turn bad. He put Solomon in place as the king. He turns bad. It goes on and on and on like this. So because these people at the time, they were good. Their motives were good. They wanted to do, they wanted to clean the temple. They wanted to restore the temple to Jehovah. So that's what they did. Later on, they became known as the Pharisees. So they began a downhill slide. That doesn't mean that the beginning part was bad. It just means that the choices that they made later were not in line with Jehovah. Yeshua said that the light of your eyes is your perspective. And Isaac has made this observation that believers, if in doubt as to whether they should do something or not do something, or believe something or not believe something, they tend to go with the negative option instead of the one that inspires a lot of hope. So follow me here. Isaac and I have observed that when presented with something that requires some revelation, because it's not necessarily actually spelled out completely in the scriptures, like celebrating Hanukkah, and most people we know jump from the not knowing to the negative bandwagon when it comes to making a conclusion about an issue that requires some extra effort to divide. I think this says a lot about the condition of the heart in all reality, and also the amount of hope those people live with. So take, for example, what to do with our grief when one of our beloved animals die. The scriptures does not say that our animals are raised with us. But neither does it say that they won't be. What do you want to believe? Do you want to believe that he won't raise them? Do you want to believe that he will? The perspective that you choose tells a lot about how much hope you live with and what you believe about the heart of Yahweh towards you. I choose to believe the best about Papa. That he loves me so much that he would raise my beloved Nate and Katie, my two big dogs, and that he would allow us to live together forever. Why not? That belief says that I truly believe that a Papa wants to give me good gifts, and that would be truly a good gift, one that no one else could give me, to raise two animals that I love so very much and I've lost. Here, death has taken them, but for him to raise them again, oh, what an incredible gift that he could give. That belief says that I think that Papa will give back to me what death has stolen. That is hope. That is hope for my heart. I choose hope. The light of my eyes and my perspective is to say that that is a possibility. And I want to believe that. I don't want to believe the negative about Papa. I want to believe the positive about Papa. Well, it's the same with Hanukkah. Okay, so no, it is not commanded in the Torah. No, it is not lined out exactly in the Torah. And there's room for people to say, no, you shouldn't celebrate it. And there's room for people to say, yes, you should. But taking one good look at the real Hanukkah opens up a ton of possibilities, does it not? So why not see the best rather than the worst? Why not choose the better than the worst? This is my desire. So as I promised when I did my basic videos on the Fall Feast of Yahweh, I said that I had a lot to speak about Hanukkah, didn't I? And yes, I did. In fact, my voice is going hoarse because I have been speaking now for 5 hours recording this incredible festival that I believe and Isaac believes is so important for us to celebrate. So I will see you in the future after Purim. I will do another teaching about Purim while it's fresh on my mind. So between now and then, you have a couple new moons. You have lots of Shabbats to celebrate. And I will see you on the other side of Purim. So have a wonderful day. Shalom, everyone. Thank you for viewing my long Hanukkah basics video. So now you know some of the basics about Hanukkah. And I hope that you choose to dedicate your temple to Yahshua Elohim, back to your original purpose. And I pray that you have eyes to see and ears to hear. Shalom. So my husband had a little epiphany. Is that funny? Little plant. Why did they say that? Why is it named a pit? Why is a something that you all of a sudden realize, why is that named epiphany? Does it mean that now that I have the knowledge, I am now God on earth? I don't know.